Okay, so we're now going to continue with some specific summarization techniques in the next few segments. I'm going to start by one of the most classic papers by Bax and Dell from 1958. So he introduced the so-called positional method, which works very well for some specific genres of text, for example, scientific papers. He analyzed 200 paragraphs and he figured that the first and the last sentences of the paragraph are the ones that contain the most useful information. Because that's where the topic sentences are typically located according to the style that was used for that type of documents. So this was a very naive yet reasonable approach given the state of the art 55 years ago. And this paper is always cited as the first paper on automatic summarization. And it has been very influential in the field. As you can see, many of the other papers that follow use this kind of technique as their starting point. So the next paper is by Loon from IBM, 1958. So he was also summarizing technical documents. He was also one of the first people to do stemming, automatic stemming of words, and removal of stop words. And he was using as features the frequency of content terms. And according to his methodology, the words that are not the most frequent ones, such as stop words, and not the least frequent ones, those the ones that appear just once in a document, are the most informative ones. So the E metric that is shown in this diagram reaches its maximum for words that are in the middle range based on their frequency. So sentences that contain those words are deemed to be more worthy of inclusion in the summary. So there's sentence level significance factor based on the presence of the words with the high E values. And he wanted to pick sentences that have a large concentration of salient content terms. So for example, if you have a sentence represented on the top of the slide, and you have four significant words in it that appear within a span of seven words, then the score for that particular cluster of significant words is going to be four squared, which is the number of significant words squared divided by the length of the span in which they appear, so about 2.3. So as you can see, this is a very reasonable metric because it focuses on two important things for summaries, significant words and also their high concentration near each other rather than them being dispersed around the document. A more recent paper is by Edmondson from 1969. It also uses technical documents and uses the features of position and frequency just as in previous work, but also looks at keywords. Keywords are categorized further into bonus words and stigma words. So bonus words are things like significant accomplishments, and stigma words are hardly and impossible. So those words are typical for scientific papers and typically indicate portions of the paper which are most informative. Edmondson also uses document structure as a feature. So is the sentence a title or heading of a section of the paper? Or is it right under one of those? So it's, for example, the first sentence of the document or the first sentence in a specific section or subsection. So he combines those four categories of features using a linear combination to pick the most important sentences. So those papers were all very early and all based on sentence extraction for technical papers. Now, a completely different approach was done by Jerry DeJong, 1979-1982, as part of his thesis at the University of Illinois. The system was called FRUMP and is one of the first knowledge-based summarization systems. So the idea was that you would automatically process a sequence of news articles from UPI and then recognize what sort of scenario they're discussing. And once you figure out what scenario is being discussed in a particular story, you would have a set of slots that need to be filled that correspond to that scenario, and then use the sentences that include the slot fillers as the summary sentences. So he created a collection of 50 so-called sketchy scripts that correspond to different situations that are often discussed in the news. And all of those are matched to scripts based on manually selected keywords. And because they're manually selected, they were very difficult to port to other domains. And it turns out that when he evaluated it, he realized that a set of 50 scripts is nearly not enough to cover all the possible inputs that you can expect to get from the news. So here's an example. One of his scenarios is so-called the demonstration category. So the script for that category involves the following events. So you have some demonstration going on. So the first thing that happens is that the demonstrators arrive at the location of the demonstration. Then they march. Then police arrives on the scene. The demonstrators communicate with the target of the demonstration. So for example, a mayor or politician or organization. Then they attack the target of the demonstration. Then they attack the police and so on. So as you can see, this is a fairly specific scenario that when it happens to match an existing news story is very valuable, but there's only so far that you can go with this kind of approach given the wide diversity of event types that occur in the news. Nevertheless, this paper was highly influential for the summarization community and for the knowledge representation communities. Okay, now more recent paper by John Pace, 1990. It is essentially a survey of all the work on text summarization up to that point, and he discusses in a lot of detail techniques that worked and many of them that actually failed. He discusses some techniques that really did not provide good results. For example, the use of syntactic criteria to pick sentences that have some specific syntactic patterns, or the presence of indicator phrases such as discourse structure phrases. He also focused on some of the points with extracts. So the idea here is that if you produce an extractive summary of a document that contains sentences that were not adjacent in the original text, you may run into issues with discourse coherence and also lack of balance. So for example, if you have a fairly balanced document that describes the points of view of two opposing factions and you end up with a summary that only describes one of those, you are thereby experiencing a lack of balance problem. Another example is lack of cohesion. So what that refers to is the fact that a sentence may start with a pronoun or a definite anaphora, and it's not clear if you don't pick the sentence that contains the antecedent what that anaphoric expression refers to. And it's even possible to get incorrect outputs. So for example, if you have three sentences, the first one talking about A, the second one about B, and the third one saying something about B, but using an anaphoric expression, for example, he. If you drop the second sentence, you're only going to have the first and the third sentence remaining, and therefore he is going to appear to refer back to A in the first sentence rather than B in the second sentence, and can therefore lead to confusion and incorrect outputs. So one of the techniques that he liked and discussed in detail was the idea of how to deal with lack of balance. So some of that has been more recently dealt with by using a rhetorical structure of text, specifically the work by Daniel Marcou, which I'm going to discuss in one of the later slides. So lack of cohesion can be addressed by using some techniques from discourse analysis. So for example, if you want to deal with issues of anaphoric reference, the presence of pronouns and definite anaphora, or the use of lexical and definite reference, you have to be able to understand and use the correct rhetorical connectives when you generate the output sentences. So it's possible to recognize that you have anaphoric use. So some of the early work on this was done by Liz Liddy in the 80s. So for example, if you want to determine if the word that is used anaphorically, you can build a classifier that looks at the context of that word and tells you in each case whether it's used anaphorically or not. So for example, if the word that is preceded by a research verb, for example, demonstrate, then that is non-anaphoric. Else, if it is followed by a pronoun, an article, or a quantifier, it's also non-anaphoric. Else, if it appears in the first 10 words of the sentence, it's external, meaning that it's not that it is anaphoric, but it refers to a referent in the previous sentence. And finally, it's internal anaphoric if it appears after the first 10 words of the sentence. So a few more papers of that time period. One is by Brando, Mitzen, Rao, 1995. This was about news articles now for change. Again, most of the previous work on summarization had to deal with scientific articles. The system was called ANES, and it included commercial news from a large number of publications. So they were able to evaluate different techniques for intelligent summarization, and they showed that the lead summaries, essentially the ones that pick the first few sentences of a document, are much more acceptable than the automatic summaries. So this was essentially a negative result for research. But yet it turned out later, based on work by other people, that this problem of having lead outperform intelligent summarizers is only applicable to news and only to certain genres of news where the journalists have been instructed to write the stories in the so-called pyramid style, where they are automatically expected to include the most important information in the first few sentences. So in the Brando et al. Paper, they looked at 20,000 documents and they looked at words based on their TF-IDF value. So TF-IDF is a concept that we're going to discuss in the information retrieval section of this class. Suffice it to say at this point is that words that have high values on this metric are more important words rather than stop words which have lower TF-IDF values. So they further used sentence-based features, for example, the presence of signature words, the location of the sentence in the paragraph, the presence or absence of anaphora words, the length of the abstract, and so on. So sentences with no signature words are included only if they appear between two selected sentences. So this is one way in which they can deal with problems with anaphora and coreference. So they evaluated their output at the 60, 150, 250 word length. And they used a non-task-driven evaluation. So they just asked people to rank the summaries, whether they're acceptable or not. So one of the other interesting papers from the 90s is by Julian Kupiec, the same person behind the Murax question answering system. This paper appeared in CIGAR 1995. It was the first use of trainable machine learning techniques for sentence extraction. Specifically, the system used a naive Bayes classifier. Its target was a 20% extract of the input, and its collection was 188 documents from scientific journals. So again, back to scientific papers. The features that were used in addition to the ones that we have already discussed include sentence length. So if the sentence has fewer than five words, it's not included. The presence of uppercase words, for example, names of places and organizations and people, except for common acronyms. The use of thematic words and a set of 26 manually fixed phrases. So the last set of features has to deal with the sentence position in the paragraph. So that's a numeric feature, a 1 to n, where n is the number of sentences in the paragraph. So here's how a naive Bayesian classifier works. You have features, like for example, F1 to FK, like the ones that I had on the previous slide. Little s is a specific sentence. A capital S is the summary. So here we're trying to compute the probability that the sentence is going to be included in the summary, given that it has a set of specific features. Then using the Bayesian formula, we convert this into the probability of the set of features, given that the sentence is in the summary, times the probability that the sentence is in the summary, divided by the prior probability of that particular set of features. So using statistical independence, we can use the chain rule and simplify this a little bit and have the value of the probability of the sentence being the summary given its features is just going to be the product of the probabilities of the individual features for the sentences that appear in the summary. So the performance of Kupiec's system was that he was getting 84% precision compared to the gold standard summaries at the 25% level. And that he was actually getting a 74% improvement over a lead-based summary when he was producing the shorter 25% summaries. So this is more encouraging for research than the Brando paper. So another paper from 1995 was by McEwen and Radev, also in CIGAR 95. It's a system called Summons, and this is the first paper that introduced the problem of multi-document summarization. So all the work before was on single news articles or single scientific papers. Here, the input is a set of news stories on the same topic that come from possibly from a variety of different sources. So the approach was essentially a knowledge-based approach where first you convert the input document into the so-called MUC template that corresponds to the specific event type. So MUC is the Message Understanding Conference. It was a competition in the mid to late 90s and early 2000s where systems were built for filling in slots that correspond to specific scenarios. For example, about mergers and acquisitions or joint ventures or terrorist events and some other types of news. So once those templates are filled out by the MUX system, the next step is to perform text generation, essentially identify how to generate sentences that contain the slot fillers of the MUX template. So that corresponds in practice to things like the perpetrator of an event or the names of the companies involved in a merger, the date and amount of the merger, and so on. So here's an example of an output of summons. This output is generated from multiple input documents. As you can see, there are reported statements, the stuff in green, that correspond to the sources of the information. And also there are indicators of agreement and disagreement between different sources. And if some specific slot is not filled in any particular document, then you can use a specific sentence to explain that there is no information about that particular slot. So here's an example of a MUX template that is used in the input to summons. In this example, this is about terrorist events. There are different slots that are filled in by the MUX systems, for example, by BBN and some other participants. There is the date of the event, the location of the event, the type of the event, and the participating entities. Some of those may be present and some of them may be missing. So summons takes as input a cluster of templates that correspond to the different input documents, and then it combines them together using a domain ontology, and then it performs multiple additional stages, which are not really relevant at this point. We are going to discuss them in more detail when we talk about text generation. So the stages are a paragraph planner, which tells you what information you want to include in each of the paragraphs that you generate. Then within a paragraph, a sentence planner that essentially determines what information we're going to in each individual sentence. Then you have a lexical chooser, which tells you what words to use to express a specific concept from the input template. And finally, it uses an off-the-shelf sentence generator called Surge, which converts the logical representation into an actual grammatical sentence and a grammatical paragraph. So here's one related example. In this case, the input consists of four different templates. And here's the output. Because there are multiple events being discussed, you have to generate specific time expressions, for example, on Sunday, the next day, in the second incident, later the same day, which make the summary more readable and more coherent. So here's some of the rules that are used in summons. So for example, if there are two templates and the location is the same and the time of the second template is after the time of the first template, and the source of the first template is different from the source of the second template, and at least one other slot differs, then combine the two templates using a contradiction operator, which later would tell the generation component that a certain connective expression should be used. And here's some of the operators used in summons: change of perspective. The precondition of change of perspective is that the same source reports a change in a small number of slots. So here Reuters gives one account on one day, and then later the same day, it actually changes its account to something very different. Another operator is contradiction. That is when multiple sources report contradictory values for a small number of slots, as opposed to the previous example where it was the same source, but different times. Another operator is refinement. That is when some slot gets filled out at some point, even though it was empty before that. There is also agreement. That's when multiple sources corroborate the same information. And there's also some other ones, such as generalization, where you have the output of two different templates and you want to combine them into one, and so on. So let me stop here, and we're going to continue with the Mitra paper in the next segment.